It is fascinating to take a look at the Genghis Khan exhibit, now open here at Union Station. Genghis Khan certainly was a conqueror, and you get to see in this collection some of the tools of his trade. Look at this giant crossbow. This is something that the Mongol army would use when they would lay siege to cities. They had to figure out how to defeat the cities that had a giant wall. Those didn't exist in Mongolia. That is a wicked weapon of war, as is what we see over here, the catapult. Now, we've all heard of catapults before, but we want to bring in Don Lessem, and he's responsible for collecting so much of this terrific exhibit. All right, so the catapult, like people know, you can fling a heavy ball or something like that, but the Mongols took that to a whole different level.
Couple of ways. One you don't know, Martin, is flaming excrement.
Oh, my gosh.
Something you don't want to be on the other side of for sure. But the cleverest was they would take weasels, marmots, from Mongolia live. Like Rocky the Flying Squirrel, they would shoot them into the city because they carry the plague, to which the Mongols were immune. They get in the water supply, everybody in the town would get bubonic plague and die.
And they just have to wait it out.
Yep. Just sit there.
Now that speaks a little bit to the ruthlessness of Genghis Khan. Let's take a walk to another end of this exhibit. Certainly, was he ruthless, or did he just see a means to an end? How would you describe Genghis Khan?
Well, it was a ruthless time, so you got to put that in the context. He was a guy with a vision, an amazing vision for a guy who was an illiterate outcast, that he was going to create, and he did, the most peaceful empire that ever lived. Freedom of religion, trial by jury, no slavery, taxes of 2%.
Not too bad.
Nice life.
So he would conquer great swaths of territory, so much of the globe, but if you survived that, you were probably in a better place than you were before.
Much better. And that, it was a meritocracy, so you, no matter what your origin, could find your way into the highest level of government.
How about that? Now, we talk about the civilization aspect of things. So the Khans would conquer a land, but then they would bring civilization to it. Now, we wanted to bring your attention to this vase right here, blue and white. Now, Don, that is no accident that this is a very valuable piece. Tell us why it is such a significant piece when it comes to the empire of Genghis Khan.
Because it's blue. There was no blue in Asia because they didn't have the dye, the indigo dye, until he conquered the Middle East, where the plants come from. So this became a huge fad in Asia. The Mongols worshipped the sky to begin with, and now they can finally produce the color of the sky. So when you look in a restaurant, a Chinese restaurant, you have to think first the Mongols are the first people to create modern China. His grandson, Kublai Khan, united it all, and then he was able to bring it that color blue.
How about that? So those little blue and white pieces of porcelain you see in the Chinese restaurant, probably trace it back to this sort of thing right here.
14th century.
How about that? All right. Now, another story we want to have Don help us tell is the one back here. And you see this painting, which illustrates boats in a giant wave. Well, Don, explain what's going on there and how that led to a phrase that a lot of us will have heard of by now in studying our most recent history.
Absolutely. Greatest invasion ever was the Mongols' attempt to conquer Japan. Really bad idea. But they had 14,000 boats, river boats, so they weren't so well equipped. And then all of a sudden, this tsunami comes along. It's the divine wind, which means in Japanese, kamikaze. That's where that word comes from. Destroy the entire fleet. 13 years later, he tried it again. Same story.
Interesting. So, and now we know where that, the origin, anyway, of the kamikaze term comes from there. Now, this great display of artifacts here at Union Station is going to be here until the end of August. I know, Don, that as much as we love seeing these relics, these ancient things, there's also people that are keeping the traditions of Mongolia alive around here. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I mean, the music that makes it hard for us to talk, that's the live music of the same songs that were played in the time of Genghis Khan. Three times a day we have Mongolian artists, came here yesterday from Mongolia, to play that music. And it's spectacular, the same tunes, the longest musical tradition in history, and these beautifully outfitted musicians are playing it, including throat singing, which if you've never heard is one of the weirdest sounds in the world.
Very good. And one last thing, Don, I want to bring up with you is the notion that the Mongol Empire still touches us to date. Again, we see these great relics, but tell us about what is in our everyday life now that we can trace back to the Mongolian Empire.
You know, we don't think about it, but you wouldn't have eyeglasses, forks, paper money, passports, Pony Express. He invented libraries, trial by jury. It's an amazing collection of Western, in quotes, stuff that we owe entirely to Genghis Khan and his invasion.
All that Western stuff that really came way from out east. So that is just a slice of what you're going to find in the Genghis Khan exhibit. So for my good friend Don Lessem and everybody here at Union Station, I'm Martin Augustine, KNBC 9 News.